Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a podcast and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from thousands of successful individuals from around the world. I'm your host, Ashutosh Garg, and today I'm delighted to welcome a very accomplished professional from Hong Kong, Mehru Terrell. Mehru, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ashutosh. Really good to be here today.
Thank you. Mehru is a business and personal branding coach for women leaders. In her own words, she was almost Miss India 1994, and she's a blogger from Miss India to motherhood. So, Mehru, my first question is to ask you about your own amazing journey. Tell me about your journey in brief.
Sure, and thank you for mentioning in brief, because I can be quite a rambler, especially when it comes to sharing my own journey. I'm basically born and brought up in Mumbai, India, Bombay then, in a typical Parsi Zoroastrian family with the right values, if I might say. I went on to doing my MBA, followed by a corporate job with the Tata Group. And right at the same time, just before that, I used to model. And through that, I had participated in the Miss India competition. So that was a very different chapter of my life. And if you just fast forward a little bit, cut to the whole got married, became a mother, moved to Hong Kong version, I just realized how different life was. I mean, one day I was walking the catwalk, looking after my posture and the way I looked and what I wore was so important to me. And the next I was thrown into this whole motherhood model wherein I didn't even know if I brushed my hair before I stepped out of the house, as long as I had the diaper with me. So really, really exciting and happy with the journey that life has shown me so far.
And what was the inspiration to move from the corporate world to coaching and personal branding expertise?
Right. I would just say one step at a time. So when I was leaving the corporate world, I did not see myself being a coach one day. But when I left the corporate world, the main pull was motherhood. Even though I went back to being in the corporate world after I had my son, I knew I was being pulled in many different directions, especially with my heart calling out to my son. And that's when I consciously decided, despite the fantastic career growth, that this is where I want to be. And I consciously became a full-time stay-at-home mom. The move to Hong Kong happened at the same time, thanks to my husband's transferable job. And from there started a whole new process, a whole new identity as a mother. I was more at my son's school and at my home rather than working in an office. But what I really did was enjoy the process of motherhood, enjoy the process of bringing up my son. And of course, I had another one after that. So that kept me busy for many years. I started blogging at the same time. And the title of my blog, From Miss India to Motherhood, just came about organically to show how different my life is now compared to a few years earlier. And just to get those mental juices flowing, I started bringing in some clothes from India, selling them in Hong Kong, realized there is a market here. Why not start my own business? Gives me the flexibility. So I launched my clothing business. And in the process of doing that, I started attending markets here in Hong Kong, wherein I met other women, other moms who were highly qualified, doctors, lawyers, teachers. I mean, they gave up their job to follow their spouse to a new country. And in that process, they became moms full time. And they also launched their own businesses because we always wanted this other identity besides being a mother and a wife. And that's when I started another business called Moms at Play, which slowly grew to a community of women entrepreneurs in Hong Kong. I still run it very successfully, having a close community of women and mom entrepreneurs, wherein we get together and we hold different events, from bazaars, wherein each person brings in the product that they want to showcase in a market, to networking meets, to workshops for business women, and so on. Well, I still haven't come to my coaching journey, have I? I think COVID was a time to pause. COVID was a time to think back and reflect about the journey that I was on. And I realized that I felt something was missing. Maybe it was age related. But it also gave me some kind of a different thought process, wherein I realized that I can actually help these entrepreneurs. I can actually help other women or even other individuals in a much more meaningful way than the platform that I was already offering. And that's how I got into the whole coaching world. I got certified as a coach, ICF coach. And I went on to doing my first level of credential and then the second level, which is the PCC level of ICF coaching. And yeah, it's really fulfilling to be a coach. So that's been my journey so far.
Amazing. So we're going to speak about personal branding because you're a personal branding coach. And we'll also speak a little bit about business coaching. So my first question relating to personal branding, and given the fact that you have focused on women leaders, what are some of the unique challenges women face when it comes to personal branding?
Right. Now, as a coach, the one thing that I brought to my coaching is a business element. I mean, being an entrepreneur, it just came naturally to me that, okay, I now have this skill, but I also need to be sure that people know about this skill. And how would they know about the skill if I tell them what I do and how I can help them? And the only way to know how I can help them is to understand their pain points, their problems. And being one myself, being a woman entrepreneur myself, having gone through that same journey, that kind of came easy to me. So I think the biggest challenge women entrepreneurs face is the balancing that they have to do between work, home, family, kids, and all of that, and finding satisfaction or even upper level, finding fulfillment in what we do. I think that's probably one of the biggest challenges that we face.
Right.
Yeah.
Well said. And Mehru, what are some of the common personal branding mistakes people tend to make, and how can these be managed?
Yeah. Again, a subject which is very close to my heart. I've seen some of these moms, entrepreneurs, even coaches, now that I'm in this community of coaches, who are brilliant at their job. Even the women entrepreneurs, they could be creating something handmade and they're so good at their job. But what they really lack is making that skill visible to the outside world. And not being able to do that, not being able to showcase that part of them is really the missing element in their branding style. So they may show the product, but they don't like showing the face behind their product. They're quite shy at doing that. That's the biggest mistake that they make, in terms of not being able to convert that product into a story, not being able to tell the world that this is what I do and this is how I do it. I would say personal branding is not a new concept. It's been there for donkey's years. In the earlier days, personal branding used to be a business card that one would probably give in a closed room of a meeting or maybe a conference, and your brand was your card.
Right.
Now, the thing is, that card has become your visibility or your digital presence in the outside world. And that room filled with people has been replaced by the global world, by internet, by social media. They are all there. They are right there. So how do you then show this card to the world to tell them this is who I am and that's what I do? Is probably the mistake that people,
Fascinating response. But you know, your response gives me a segue to my next question, which is how important is storytelling when it comes to personal branding? And you know, you mentioned a business card may have been your personal brand in the past, but how can individuals now craft their own unique story?
That's beautiful. And that's what exactly what personal branding is about, crafting your individual and crafting your unique story. Now, I always tell my coaches, my clients, that it's not about you. It's not about what you, I mean, as long as you know your strengths and know what you're good at, but it's also about your clients. How much do you know of them? How much do you know about their demographics, about where they are, what they really want? So when I say I'm a coach, it makes no sense to my clients. Okay, nice to meet you. You're a coach. But when I say, do you want to balance your world? Do you want to balance your work with your family, with your children? That's when it actually, you know, you can see that tube light shining, if I can say, that bulb coming up alive and saying, yes, I want to be able to do that. Can you help me? So writing that story in the words of your client becomes really, really important in personal branding.
Fascinating. And Mehru, what role does content creation play in personal branding? And how can individuals create impactful content?
Well, that's beautiful again, Ashutosh, because that is exactly where people get stuck. Content creation is a part of your storyboard, really. And that storyboard comes from your clients. So again, I would go back to the pain points of the clients. What are they looking for? And what are the words that they use? So as a certified coach in the process of getting trained, we are really trained to rephrase what the client is saying. Why? Because that's what really connects us to them or makes us active listeners. So being able to use the same words in your content and then having some kind of scheduling, some kind of a theme to the week of your content would make it easier for you to put that content out to people and also for them to be able to understand what you do and why you do it.
Well said. The other question often asked about personal branding is in today's digital age, how crucial is an online presence to building a personal brand? And based on your experience, what are some of the platforms that people should select? Because there are so many of them now.
Thank you for bringing that up. You're just bringing up the hot topics that my clients would be asking me. So yes, it is really important to craft your own story in the online world. You might think, why bother? My work speaks for myself. It's fair enough if you want to, say, serve the people living around you, maybe people in your building or even in your society, and you're really happy doing that and that gets you enough work, that's fine. But even if you want to serve an outer, a bigger, wider population, you need to be out there in the digital world. But even if you don't, even if you say, no, I'm not going to be online, Google makes up some kind of a story for you. And you don't want that to happen. Whenever someone types your name onto Google, unless you've been living for the last, I don't know, 40, 50 years away in a jungle somewhere, but we don't, Google definitely gets some kind of a story about you that it makes it available to your potential clients. And that's not the story you want to share. You want to be able to share the story that you want. So it's really important for you to take charge of the content out there that's available under your name. To answer your other question about which social platform, again, see where your clients are. If your clients are on LinkedIn, then be on LinkedIn. If they are on Instagram, be on Instagram. However, some people, including myself, we have two, three different platforms running at the same time. My advice to you is that if you're absolutely brand new on a platform, just build your identity there for 6 months, at least 6 months. Focus on LinkedIn or Instagram or Facebook, whatever it is, and put all your energies onto one platform before you start with the other. That's my only advice, because too often people just want to be seen everywhere. You're on Twitter, you're on Instagram, you're on TikTok, and that doesn't work because you will not be able to do everything yourself. Each social media needs a certain kind of content and a certain kind of message. So it's not like you just replicate and you'll just burn yourself out. So
well
do
said.
one social media at a time.
Well said. So Mehru, now let me move to business coaching. I have a few questions for you on business coaching. My first question is, what are some of the common barriers high potential women leaders face in their careers, and how do you coach them to overcome these?
The imposter syndrome.
Yeah.
The feeling that I'm not good enough is just so inherent in us. I don't know if it's the upbringing, the world we live in, but I see women work at least three times more than men doing the same thing.
I agree.
In this, and probably trying to prove to herself more than anyone else that she can do it and she will do it. So this imposter syndrome is the biggest challenge that women face. The lack of self-confidence. Although they're really good, it's not like people are not praising you. People are. People value what you do, etc., etc. But it's that inner voice which is so difficult to quieten. I call it the sage versus the saboteur voices in our head that are constantly at play. And when the saboteur voices get louder and louder and louder, and that's when no matter what you do, you never do enough in your own mind.
Yeah.
So being able to quieten those saboteur voices and really increase the volume of the sage is something that coaching can really help with.
Very interesting.
What I also tell people about coaching is that it is future focused. So don't worry about what's happened in the past. Focus on the present and let's keep moving towards the future.
Great response. My next question for you, Mehru, is on culture. You know, you live in a very, very multicultural city like Hong Kong. How do you address cultural diversity when it comes to coaching?
Yes, that's again a really important point. And I think even when the coachee selects a coach, they do try and find some similarities in culture, similarities in the background, because they just want to find someone who's like them, who would understand where they come from and understand their needs. It's not like you can't have a coach from a different background who won't understand your needs, but it's perception. At the end of the day, it's all about perception.
Correct.
So as a coach, what I do is I come up, I present myself in an absolute non-judgmental manner. No matter what story they bring, no matter where they come from, for them, I'm their coach. I also have this belief that we are both on the same platform. So whether in terms of diversity, if you are a student or if you are a CEO of a company, for me in my coaching call, you are my equal. And I think that's at the foundation of just being able to bring out what the coachee wants from a call, just at the same level. And that really addresses any kind of perception or any kind of diversity, anything which is different. It just doesn't matter because we both are on the same stage, same right. platform, and I'm right. here for you.
Well said. So we have time for two more questions, and these two questions are for you now personally. Mehru, given your amazing background of, you know, corporate world, beauty pageant, coaching, how has your own background supported your coaching philosophy, your style, and your values?
All right. I love that question. So like I said, being born and brought up in a Zoroastrian household, our core values of Zoroastrianism, good thoughts, good words, and good deeds, are so embedded in our religion, in our culture, in our community. It is that first and everything else after that. And coaching, the very thing, the very first thing in coaching that you as a coach need to bring about and they as a client really look from you is trust.
Right.
Because what they're about to share with you, or just being able to voice their fear, being able to sound out their dreams, they really need that bond of trust. And as long as you bring that, you're sorted, you're good. So I would say my upbringing as well, the way we've been brought up, and good thoughts, good words, good deeds, certainly set a foundation to my coaching practice.
Well said. And my last question to you, Mehru, and this is, how have you been shaped by people in your life? And how are they influencing you as a coach today?
Wow. All right. I think at every, or if I were to look at my life as a book, every decade as a chapter, I think there has always been someone who's guided me, influenced me. And now if I have to look back, it was probably my mother who played a significant role in my life, in probably the first or for the first 15 years of my life, being brought up by my mother, who was also a stay-at-home mom, and who selflessly gave us her time, her attention, was always there for us. And when I'm saying us, it's my sister and myself. Followed by my one of my really, really closest friends, if I look at the second and the third decade of my life, who is no longer there in this world today, but who was always there for me, who would root for me and cheer any dreams, anything that I had. He was always there for me. Then, of course, my husband, I call him my rock. He's my pillar. Followed by my children. I think my children have taught me more than what I could teach them. Just bringing them up has been the single most happiest period of my life. So yes, at every stage, I've had a different teacher, if I can put them like that. That kind of sort of influences me in a way that I practice my coaching today. And honestly, you know what, Ashutosh, I've never really thought about this till you brought it out today. So thank you so much for that question.
Thank you so much. Thank you for such a great response. And on that note, Mehru, I want to say thank you so much for speaking to me about your own amazing journey. And, you know, you seem to have handled so many different things, but what has come out so strongly in our conversation is the amazing amount of gratitude you seem to have in almost everything that you have done. Thank you for speaking to me at such length about personal branding and about business coaching. Thank you again, and good luck to you.
Thank you so much, Ashutosh. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the brand called You Videocast and Podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website, www.tbcy.in, to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for the brand called You.